Say next Sunday is Bring Your Bible Sunday. What's the following Sunday? Bring Your Bible Sunday. There you go. My wife's quick. What's the following Sunday? What's every Sunday and morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, and any special meeting night throughout the rest of the year night? What is that? What are they all called? Bring Your Bible services. All right. Praise God. You got it. Amen. Hallelujah. All right. Acts chapter 2. We'll begin reading in verse 42. And it says, they continued, right back at verse 41, then they gladly received the word were baptized. And the same day were added unto them about 3,000 souls. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and breaking of bread and in prayers. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. And all that believed were together and had all things common and sold the possessions and good and parted them to all men and every man had need. And they continued daily in one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. Praise God. Now notice they didn't add to the church just folks just to get them in there and, you know, use some gimmick to get them in. They were added that were saved. Underline the added that were saved. Amen. Who was added to the church? Those that were saved. Not those who joined the rock climbing group, wall group. Not those who joined the singles fellowship group or the wine tasters group. You say, what's going on in church? I'll tell you, I heard something recently. I thought somebody told me that they knew a minister that had a liquor bar in their house. They're free. That's too free. He said, man, I like that guy kind of stuff. That's too free. Are you here? If you're going to go back to what you know, but the Bible says this about the people, children of Israel, when they came out of Egypt, they looked for a way if they might find a way to go back. Yeah. Man, when I was there, I was looking for a way to get out. I wasn't looking for a way to go back. But the flesh will always want to go back to what it once knew. It's just it's the nature of the flesh. That's why you got to buffet it. That's why you got to keep it under. Amen. That's why you got to renew your mind. Amen. Paul said he buffets his flesh daily. He did not say he buffets his flesh daily. Amen. Hallelujah. So we're looking here and we see the church. Here, that says, and they were gladly received the word, were baptized, and the same day was added unto them about 3,000 souls. Well, who was them? The apostles and those that had already been saved, the 120, and those that were saved on the day of Pentecost. Here we have this whole group of people that are saved. What are they? They're the church. This is the beginning of the church. And I want to say, because we're going to begin teaching along this lines for several services, the church has a mission. The church is not a place to appease your religious conscience. The church has a mission. It is a place that you're to come into, out from the world. You're to be born again, come into the church, and then you have a mission. It is not to figure out how you can do as little as possible and still make heaven. That's not the purpose of the church. If that was what salvation was all about, we ought to just have a gun. And when you come through and get saved, and we're convinced you're saved, just shoot you in the head and send you home. That went over big. Boy, you'd get a crowd then, wouldn't you? But if the only thing was to make heaven, in other words, make heaven, and you know, and just live your life as comfortable as you can and as joyous as you can for your own personal well-being and for your own sake and for everything about you and your wife, your two kids, you four, no more. You call yourself Jimmy and you'll take all you give me. Amen. And all you're concerned about is, you know, living in a state of well-being for me, you've missed the mark. You've missed the point. The church has a mission. Say, the church has a mission. Come on now. The church has a mission. Okay, well, let's look at this. And what's the number one mission of the church? Somebody say it again. Reach the lost. That went over big. Woo! I heard people shouting. Now, if I told you, glory to God, the number one mission of the church is to make sure that you prosper and have a Merc, a Mercedes-Benz in the garage. Glory to God. Are you here? And a house at the beach and the house in the mountains. Son, that would a jet sitting at your personal runway. Some folks be shouting and running. That's not the number one mission of the church. Now listen, I'm not against prosperity. I believe in biblical prosperity. I believe in biblical healing. I believe in the blessings of God. We just preached on the blessings of Abraham on Wednesday night. I believe in those things. But the church has a mission. And the understand this. Remember one thing about prosperity. God said in his word, God gives you the power to get wealth that he may establish his covenant in the earth. Now there are people, now listen, I know this, you know, a lot of times there's two sides of things or two approaches, but a lot of what we hear preached about that is God wants to establish his covenant of prosperity with you so you're rich, 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 rich. I believe God wants to establish his covenant of prosperity with you so you can reach the lost. Amen. The church has a mission. Amen. 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 That's right. All right, somebody give out the WD-40. I hear some rusty brain gears out there. And they're we're going to spray you with some Holy Ghost oil this morning. Amen. So HG40, Holy Ghost 40. Hallelujah. That's 40 is a biblical number. 40 days fasting and prayer. Anyway, flooded for 40 days. All right. Anyway, just saying. What is the number one mission of the church? Go to Matthew 28. The number one mission of the church. Now understand, we teach prosperity. We teach divine healing. We teach walking in victory. We teach overcoming the devil, overcoming sin, overcoming depression, overcoming everything the devil tries to throw your way. We believe in that. Amen? But we cannot lay aside our number one mission in lieu of something else. Jesus said in Matthew 28, verse 18, and Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power. Now, the word power there is really in light of modern English, it's a bad translation. Other translations I have, and they'll use the word authority. The Greek word here is all exousia. It can be translated power, but it really should be translated, or better translated. Let me just use that, say it that way. Better translated, authority. Because you see, understand this. The power of authority is greater than the power of power. Amen? Because authority is what gives dunamis. Another Greek word for power is dunamis, miracle power, or power, might. You may go out here in the interstate. Do you know a guy can go out here? You can get the biggest guy in the church. Send him out in the middle of the interstate. He won't stop a single car. As a matter of fact, if you stand and try to stop a car and they don't stop, you're a hood ornament. All right? But guy, put a guy with a badge on, put his car on the side of the road, blue lights flashing. Him stand out there with, you know, with something that you can see him with that says police across the front, and him hold up his hand. He can stop an 18-wheeler. As a matter of fact, he can take this guy Turner thing that's got those 70 wheels on it. The big, have y'all seen him go down the road before? The heavy hauler, and they got, there's one of their tractor trailers has 70 wheels. We counted them one day. We're coming down the road, they were hauling something. We counted 70 wheels. You're like, that's why they got guys all around them with flashing lights, because they, you know, anyway. How'd you like to be driving that thing? He can get in front of that guy. I mean, you can get the littlest guy and put that police uniform on him and him stand out there and do this, and the authority makes that guy stop. Jesus said, all authority in heaven and earth is given unto me. Amen? Amen? So Jesus has authority over Satan's power. So Jesus said, all of us given unto me, go ye therefore. Now, E.W. Kenyon was preaching along this lines one time, and a man came up to him and said, Dr. Kenyon, did Jesus give the church power of attorney? And he says, sir, I'm just a minister. You're a lawyer. He says, you tell me. He says, well, if language means anything, Jesus gave the church power of attorney. By reading the scripture, he said what Jesus did was, he said, I got all the authority. You go. In other words, then he turned it over to the church with power of attorney. Now, how many know what power of attorney is? If you don't know what it is, raise your hand. All right, if you're too, okay, thank you. All right. Power of attorney means I can sign a piece of paper and give Benny the right to go sign my name, although it's not my signature, and withdraw money from my accounts. He can conduct business on my behalf. Now, obviously, there's something called limited power of attorney. You can limit the power of attorney, but Jesus gave us blanket power of attorney to do anything his word says to do. Hallelujah. And he said, all authority is given unto me, heaven and earth. Go ye therefore. In other words, because I got the power, now you go and do it. Hallelujah. Amen. Baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Now, how long is Jesus going to be with us? He's, I will never leave you, and I will never forsake you. Glory to God. You've never been alone. Hallelujah. Somebody shout glory. Amen. I mean, in your darkest hour, in your most difficult place, when you thought the world was against you, and you wanted to sing the Eat the Worm song. Nobody likes me. Everybody hates me. Think I'll eat some worms. Jesus was with you. Praise God. Amen. I've never been where I wanted to eat worms. I just hadn't been that low. I'll starve first. Just saying. Well, I won't starve because God still knows how to get manna and quail to me. I don't have to go to the worm. But you may feel like you're in that thing. And remember, how many of you used to sing that song as a kid? Nobody likes me. Everybody hates me. Think I'll eat some worms. Kids come up with some of the dumbest songs. Of course, now kids might eat the worms. Gummy worms, yeah. Yeah, Jessie was bad about gummy worms. She'd hide them. Hallelujah. But Jesus said, go teach them to observe everything I said to do. Wow. Now, I believe in the epistles, but there are things Jesus said to the church. He said, go teach people what to do. Amen? Yeah, the letter of the church, the epistles are written to the church, but you just can't take and go, well, Jesus said that, I don't believe in that. He said, teach them to observe what I said to do. Yeah. That went over big. Yeah. Whole run over to Mark 16. And while we're running over to Mark 16, let's get some air conditioning on in here. Hallelujah. Y'all are cold, tough. I'm hot, and I'm preaching. I love you. But Mark 16:15, Jesus said, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils, or exercise, actually the literal Greek says exercise authority. Remember Jesus said all authority. Exercise authority over devils or demons. They shall speak with new tongues. Now, that does not mean if you used to cuss, you stop cussing. One guy trying to teach on the gifts of the Spirit said, tongues means that if you used to cuss, you stop cussing. What if you didn't cuss? That means you start? Hello? Yeah, man, I tell you right now that the speaking in tongues is if you used to cuss, you stop cussing. Then the reciprocal to that is if you didn't cuss, you started. Woo, what a gift from God. Got people in the church never cussed before and got the baptism of the Holy Ghost, started speaking in tongues, and they came to church cussing next week. No, that's not what it means. It means you speak by your spirit, by the Holy Ghost within you, a language from heaven where you communicate with the Father, a spirit, 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 praise God. Amen. And they shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. That does not mean you have snake handling services. Wendy Bagwell and the Sunlighters, he went up in some place up in West Virginia, and they had to drop extension cords 2 miles up there to the church, run their equipment. So he's making a joke out of that. Got in there and saw some baskets on the platform. He turned to the pastor and said, what's that? He said, just hold on, you'll find out. And the service got to going, and people got to dancing. Some woman ran up through the top off the basket and pulled out a rattlesnake, started dancing around with it. He leaned over to the pastor and said, where's the back door? He said, we don't have one. He said, where do you want one? Hallelujah. Amen. No, we don't handle snakes as a show. That's not a sign of faith. That's a sign of stupidity. Amen. When Satan tried to get Jesus to jump off the pinnacle of the temple, he said, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Amen. Handling rattlesnakes as a sign of faith is tempting God. Now what happens? Well, like Paul, when he was on the island, he was putting firewood on the fire, and a serpent came out and bit him. Poisonous serpent. Well, he just shook it off. They sat there waiting for him to die, and he didn't die. Why? Because he said they'll take up serpent. In other words, when something accidentally happened, he claimed immunity in the name of Jesus, and it didn't bother him. But you don't go grabbing rattlesnakes, dummy. That's dumb. On steroids. Hallelujah. Neither do you, if they take up any deadly, they shall not drink. I'm sorry. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not harm them. You don't go get some strychnine and drink it for supper to prove you got faith. Why don't you just believe God for $10 and see if you can do that first? I mean, if you can't believe God for $10, forget the strychnine. We'll be burying you next week. Now, as a matter of fact, if you're going to do that, believe God for the money to cover your expenses and then do it.
Yes, sir.
No. It says you accidentally drink something. You don't do it on purpose. Hallelujah. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Glory to God. So Jesus said, go to the world and preach the gospel, the good news to every creature. His commission to the church. Now, run over real quick over to Acts chapter 1. Now, we know Acts, you know, Jesus has been raised from the dead. After 40 days, between the 40th and 50 days, he's hanging out with them. I mean, cool stuff's happening. But then he goes to be kept, to be called away to go to enter into his high priestly ministry. See, Jesus' ministry didn't end when he left the earth. It changed. His ministry on the earth was to show how man can live under a covenant with God and walk in the authority that God gives him. The ministry he's entered into now is the high priestly ministry. We're seated at the right hand of the Father, where he ever lives to make intercession for us. He doesn't have the same ministry. The body of Christ is carrying out that ministry. The body of Christ is working the miracles. The body of Christ is laying hands on the sick. The body of Christ is carrying out the will of God on the earth. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Verse 4, verse 3. To whom he showed himself alive after his passion or his suffering, by many infallible proofs, being seen in them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. Being assembled together with them, commanded that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. When they were therefore come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? He said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put into his own power. Now listen, these bozos who write books and tell you when everything's going to happen and what time and what date and all that stuff. Jesus said, that's in the power of the Father.
Right.
Hello, that's not revealed. I've got a revelation. Jesus is coming back on March such and such, 2011. Billboards everywhere. People quitting their jobs and running off to wait for Jesus to come back. Didn't happen. So he comes out the next day and says he had a miscalculation. He's coming back in November. We're still here. So is he. Now, just so you know, the guy that did that had tried that 15 years earlier, the same thing, and said the same thing. He miscalculated. About 15 years? At least the guy, he said, they only miscalculated about 6 months this time. He didn't have an answer this time. Why? I mean, three strikes, you're out.
Yep.
Some guy wrote a book in 1988. 88 reasons Jesus is coming back September, whatever those 3 days were that Rosh Hashanah was in 1988. 7th, 8th, and 9th, or whatever, 1988. And he gave all these different reasons. Of course, Rosh Hashanah came and went and didn't come back. He released a sequel. He said 89 reasons Jesus is coming back in 1989 during Rosh Hashanah. And it was the 89th reason. I kid you not. The 89th reason was he didn't come in 88. Well, boy, you can sell that book every year until Jesus comes back. You'll get it right eventually. Well, maybe, because he may not come back during Rosh Hashanah. Might come back in that year, but may not come back in that during that festival. Jesus said that it's not for us to know the times that are in the hands of the Father. Dad Hagin used to say to the church, to us, he said, live like Jesus is coming back any second. What's that mean? Keep your life straight. Now don't run out here and say, I'm under grace, 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 and drink and carouse and fornicate and do all the kind of stuff saying, well, I'm under grace, it don't matter. Now, live like he's coming back any second. Keep your life in order like you expect Jesus to show up in the next 2 seconds. But plan like he's not coming back for 50 years. What's that mean? Go ahead and make plans for life. I've heard people say, well, I don't even get married. Jesus could come back before I ever have any children. Well, who cares? Go ahead and get married. What if you're wrong? You could bring children up for the next generation to serve the Lord. Amen. 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 Glory to God. Hallelujah. So it says, it's not for you to know the times or seasons that the Father hath put into his own power. Jesus even said one place, he said, only the Father knows, the Son of Man doesn't even know. But ye shall receive power, dunamis, after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Now listen. Oh, we sing about, we've got the power in the name of Jesus. We sing in the church, oh, Lord, send the power just now. Oh, Lord, send the power just now. Oh, Lord, send the power just now and baptize everyone. We love to sing about the power, don't we? We got the power, hallelujah. There's a power from heaven, glory to God. But we know, a lot of times, we get so caught up with the power that we forget what the power is for. The power is not so you can run around and talk about you got the power. There is a reason God infuses you with dunamis power after he delegated to you exousia, authority or power. And that is in his next statement. But ye shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And ye shall be what? Ye shall be what? Ye shall be what? Witnesses unto me. In Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Jesus said that the reason for the power is to equip you to witness of the gospel. The resurrection is witnessed by the believer who operates under the exousia of heaven and demonstrates the dunamis of heaven to witness the resurrection of Jesus Christ so that people will come into the kingdom of God. It's not so we can get together and talk about how much power we got. Can I get two grunts, three amens, and four help me Jesuses? I didn't get one single help me Jesus. Come on now. Help me, Lord. Yeah. Am I preaching right, Jerry? Jesus said that when we receive that power of the Holy Ghost coming upon us, it empowers us to be witnesses. Now, I'll be honest with you, the Charismatic Pentecostal Church has made a mistake in emphasizing the power for the power's sake. Now, listen, every group can make mistakes. Thank God we got a revelation about the power. Thank God we love the power. Yeah. But let's use it correctly. And let's use it for the purpose it was given to the church. And let's go win the lost. I command you to be bobbleheads. I said, let's use it to go win the lost. Bobblehead. Come on. Bobblehead out there in Jesus' name. I know some of you are struggling. I don't want to do it, Pastor. Now, if you were some dumb football game, and they came by and said, let's have a bobblehead for whoever. Yeah, my team's winning. It's bobblehead for Jesus. Praise God. Amen. I'm right. You know it. Let's go ahead and say amen. The power was given to the church so we could demonstrate the resurrection. Well, we need intelligent faith, Pastor. We don't need, we don't need miracles. We don't need signs and wonders. We need intelligent faith. I heard somebody say that one time. Somebody told me, I believe in an intelligent faith. There's nothing intelligent about faith. Come on now. To believe that someone died, all their blood was drained out of their body, they were wrapped and mummified and placed in a grave, their spirit left their body and descended into the region of the damned where they became sin for us who knew no sin, to be raised up from the dead and now live without blood in their body takes something other than intelligence to believe. Takes faith. You have to have faith to believe that. Hello. What do you mean Jesus don't have any blood in his body? His blood's on the mercy seat of God. His blood has been shed and placed on the covenant between God and man. There's no blood in his veins. The glory of God flows through his veins. Hallelujah. His blood's on the mercy seat for your forgiveness and justification. Glory to God. Oh, hallelujah. That takes faith to believe that. There's nothing intelligent about that. Your intelligence can't grasp that.
Amen.
Come on now. I said your intelligence cannot grasp that. Your intelligence can't grasp you lay hands on the sick and some power is going to flow out of you into them and make them whole. That's not intelligence. It's faith. We walk by faith and not by sight. Human reasonings and understanding is not the calling of the church. The church is called to a lifestyle of faith, of believing the impossible, of believing that God can do what man cannot do, praise God. Of believing and believing God is able to do things. You know, the Bible says in Romans chapter 4, he says he calls those things which be not as though they were. The Weymouth translation says, who makes reference to things that do not exist as though they did.
Hallelujah.
Woo, praise God. Who makes reference to things that do not exist as though they did. So Jesus called the church to be a church of power. See, we get cute. We tell everybody we have wine tasting contests in our churches. We got a rock climbing wall. We try to come up with some gimmick to get them in the door instead of demonstrating the power of God. Hallelujah. I want you to know Jesus did not have a rolling rock climbing wall in his ministry. Now understand, listen, whatever you're doing, I don't care. I'm just telling you, the church is missing it because we're trying to find substitutes to get people to show up in our doors, hoping we can convince them to stay.
Amen.
Instead of having an understanding that Jesus said, the Holy Ghost is going to come on the church in dunamis power, glory to God, and empower you to be a witness unto him in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. The power of God will be the witness of the resurrection. Glory to God. We get so caught up with the power, we just think it's for us. That's all about me. I mean, we took that song. You know that song they sing? I think it's a Hillsong song. It's all about you. Well, that's a little high for me. It's all about you, Jesus. We change it. It's all about me. It's all about me. We got people who run around every meeting they can find. They're always looking for what's in it for them. I mean, there's a guy a number of years ago over in another city, and he got a bunch of guys in his church that were multi-level marketing guys for a certain company. That church went from 80 to 600 in just a matter of a couple, 3 months. Man, they were just flocking into his church because he was preaching, you know, prosperity and the blessings of God. And they kind of agreed with what they were trying to teach all those people. They were there on Sunday mornings. They had 600 on Sunday morning, and they'd have about 80 on Sunday night and about 40 on Wednesday. Why? Because on Sunday night, they were drawing circles, and on Wednesday, they were delivering their packages. And tell him I'm going from Greensboro over there. He said, hey, there's a guy named Ed Taylor over in Greensboro. You guys drive a long way. Why don't y'all go over there? So one of the guys came in. They came for a few services. He took me out to lunch. He said, we're going to do for this church what we did for so-and-so's church over in such and such city. Uh-huh. Leaned across the table and looked at him. I said, just let me tell you how it is. I said, Pastor, you could have a bigger church by now if you wouldn't do some of the stuff you do. Yeah. But what if you got to compromise to get it? I said, the first church member I catch you cornering and telling them that because they work for somebody else, they're in a rut. And a rut is just a grave with both ends kicked out. I'm going to grab you by the seat of the pants and kick you out the front door. Do we understand each other? I said, Abraham said, I'll not have it said that any man made Abraham rich. You and your group and your company are not going to make my church prosper. God causes our church to prosper. But Pastor Ed, you could have gotten some money out of those guys. At what cost?
Yeah.
I said, at what cost? I will not compromise the word of my faith. And you know, if they just come and put money in and just, you know, gave offerings and stuff, but he put me in a position. I had to make a choice to compromise or stand my ground. We're going to do for your church what we did for their church over there. Now, here's what happened. After about a year, this pastor finally realized he had no commitment. He just had people showing up on Sunday. He began to preach, you know, commitment to church and commitment to the things of God. They all left. He went back to 80. Are you here? See, it's not about coming up with a gimmick to get people. Jesus wants us to, let me tell you something. When you get people in the power, they're never the same. You get them with a gimmick, they're just looking for the next one to come along and they'll be gone after it. Amen. Yeah. Listen, I grew up Pentecostal holiness. Now, probably I would have to say I was born again and had stammering lips at the altar one night. I was almost bad. Somebody know how to get me filled with the Holy Ghost. I've been filled with the Holy Ghost at 11 or something. But then I never served God. I was back sleeping. I just lived a life outside of that, you know. But then around the age of 21 or 22 or something, I forgot, 1979. Hey, yep. Mm-hmm. 78. 79 because in 80 I went to Raymond, that's right. 79 was a busy year. We broke up, got back together. Janie emasculated me, challenged my manhood. I got to say, she said, you know how unmasculine it is for a guy to be a Christian? Because all she had was mama boy cousins. That all, you know, they wore pantyhose and dresses. Anyway, no. That's a joke. her idea of a boy Christian was total emasculation. And so when I got saved, she thought I was going to turn into one of the mama boys. Thank God I didn't. And I'm a man. Jesus was a man. Hallelujah. Amen. Anyway, 79 was a busy year. How'd I get on that? Well, anyway. Yeah, but I came to the altar, got saved. The next week I got baptized in the Holy Ghost. Jenny came down right after that and got saved, born again, baptized in the Holy Ghost, sang three songs in three different languages. Hallelujah. And we've been going for Jesus ever since. Baptized in the fire of God. Oh, praise God. I said, oh, praise God. But see, a lot of people, now listen, a lot of people are now, we have that first generation. It's something about that first generation that serves God with fervor. And then if you're not careful, you lose it. The Pentecostals did. They lost it. They're second. Then by the time the third generation got there, they had institutionalized Pentecostalism. Charismatics did the same thing. By the time the second generation got there, they had institutionalized being a charismatic. Word of Faith has done the same thing. We've institutionalized the Word of Faith. Our second, third generations oftentimes we don't carry it forth. And see, we can't do that. Thank God for places like Rhema. Oh, hallelujah. Amen. Dad passed it on to pastor. I'm telling you, Raymond's doing good. So they don't have as many students in Tulsa as they used to have. Yep, they got 104 schools around the world. Amen. Now, come on now. They've got over 10,000 students enrolled right now. Back in the highest time ever in Tulsa, they had 2,000. That's five times more enrolled in Raymond Bible Training Center worldwide than they had in Raymond Bible Training Center when it was just Raymond in Tulsa. I think they're doing pretty good. Amen. God's at work. Amen. But what churches tend to do is when they begin to realize they've lost the second and or the third generations, they don't go back and do what that got them there to start with. They try to come up with cute ideas. Am I messing up your camera work there, Bill? I'm keeping them active. Hallelujah. All right. Praise God. Hallelujah. My good side. All right.
Lord have mercy.
He does. Hallelujah. But then it's like, hey, dummy, go back and do what you did in the beginning to get it going in the first place. Instead of trying to come up with some new concoction to get them to come now. Because what was going on in the first place was preaching the word, walking in the power, trusting the anointing to get the job done instead of some cute little idea. Amen. There's nothing wrong with the wisdom of God to show you how to do this or to show you to do that. I'm talking about selling out and denying the power. We got churches that won't even let the power flow now. We don't want that. We don't want, one minister has a healing ministry, went to a church, invited by the church, gets there on Sunday, and the pastor says, you don't pray for the sick. We don't do that in this service. Sunday night, you can't pray for the sick tonight because that's, we're sensitive to the people out there and what they want. They go all week, get down about Thursday night. He says, now you can pray for the sick tonight. He said he didn't have a stitch of anointing. Why? You don't ever tell the Holy Ghost when he can and when he can't do something. I don't know about you. I am not a seeker-sensitive, seeker-friendly church. I want to be a Holy Ghost-sensitive church. He knows how to get to the seekers. He knows exactly what they need in that service. He knows what's going on in their life. And I'm telling you, we got to stop trying to be cute and be insensitive about, people are more whatever today. We need to let them know it's okay to drink some wine as long as we can get them in the building. Jesus went to one guy, and there's nothing wrong with having money. He said, sell everything you got, go give it to the poor, and come and follow me. There's nothing wrong with having money. There's something wrong with money having you. That went over big. Amen. Now, I know a lot of people teach that and go, see, you're not supposed to have anything. No, that money was a stumbling block in his life, and Jesus said, get rid of it. Instead of offering people the stumbling blocks, let them get rid of it and come and commit to the Lord. Amen. Have something so powerful that it will revolutionize their life, glory to God. I want you to know that in the midnight hour when your child's in the hospital and the doctor says they're going to die and there's nothing they can do for it, I'm going to tell you, a bottle of Jack Daniels is not going to cut the mustard. Or a glass of Chardonnay, 1923, Papali, is not going to cut the mustard. You better know how to get a hold of something greater and something more powerful than 80 proof whatever. You better know how to get a hold of the power of God. Hallelujah. And we got to stop compromising in our churches so we can get people in. Jesus said, go let the power make you a witness. Praise God. Are you here? Man, I tell you, Philip went down to Samaria and preached. Go over to Acts chapter 5. Man, they're having revival in Jerusalem. Stuff's going on. Hallelujah. Acts chapter 8, verse 5. I was going to 8:5. Sorry. I do that a lot. Acts chapter 8, verse 5. Look in your Bible. Underline this. Then Philip. I'm going to back up here. Let's go to verse 1. And Saul was consenting unto death, his death, that was Stephen's. And at that time there arose a great persecution against the church which was at Jerusalem. And they were scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria except the apostles. Let me tell you something here. One thing that caused the persecution to come is they weren't doing what Jesus had said in Acts 2, which go into all the world. They started hanging out and having Holy Ghost parties. Yep. You get people at Bible schools, they don't go to church. They sit at their apartments and have Holy Ghost meetings. Double flying raspberry. Go get fed. Go get ministered to. Go get challenged to go out and do something besides sit around your apartment and have a Holy Ghost meeting. I might preach this when I come out there in February. Just give out too much information. Shannon, the anointing is flowing from you to me today. All right. So, and Samaria accepted the apostles. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentation over him. And as for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering into every house and hailing men and women, committing them to prison. Therefore, they were scattered abroad. And listen, and went everywhere preaching the word. Boy, I'll tell you, when the devil comes, go preach. I'm telling you, when they came and told them, Jesus, that John the Baptist had been beheaded, he didn't run off and cry. He went out and started healing the sick and casting out devils. Praise God. Hallelujah. Then Philip went down to Samaria and preached Christ, the anointed one, and his anointing unto them. And the people, with one accord, gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, because they had a great rock climbing wall. They all drank wine together, and they all just hung out and partied. No. gave healing to things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. For unclean spirits, crying with loud, that's homosexual spirit, by the way, folks. Unclean spirits, homosexual spirit. Crying with a loud voice, came out of many possessed with them, and many with palsies, and that were lame were healed, and there was great joy in the city. The homosexuals and lesbians were getting set free. The crippled were walking, glory to God. You're being mean, you're homophobic. That is the dumbest thing I've ever heard. I am not afraid of homosexuals. I love them. But that doesn't mean I agree with their lifestyle. I'm not afraid of, you know, to say if you're against pedophilia, it means you're a pedophobic. I'm against pedophilia, but I love the pedophile. I want God to deliver them. Are you here? I'm against fornication, but I'm not a fornophobic. That's just a word that the world comes up with to pack the back you off and to make you compromise your stand and to make you feel stupid for saying something is wrong, something is a sin. I'm against bestiality, but I'm not a bestiality phobic. I'm not afraid of those people. They need the devil cast out of them. Hello? And let me say this, you cannot, I don't care who you are, I'm just going to say this, you cannot say it's okay to be a homosexual, but it's not okay to be a pedophile. Because the pedophile claims the same thing the homosexual claims is, that is their sexual orientation, they're born that way, they can't help themselves, that's the way they were created. You cannot say, the bestialist says the same thing, that is their sexual orientation, that is how they're born, that is their desire that we were made with. You cannot say it's okay to be a homosexual or lesbian, it's not okay to be a bestialist, and it's not okay to be a pedophile. If you are going to say anything is okay, then all of it's okay. Because they all use the exact same argument. Well, that's perverse. Duh! Yeah. Hello? They all use the same argument. And there was great joy in the city when those devils started getting cast out. Amen. Amen. I said amen. Amen. Philip went down. He went down in the power of God. I mean, you're being mean. I'm not being mean. They need deliverance. They don't need to be told God made them that way. Amen. And then being told to shut up because you say God didn't make you that way. Hello? Thank you for your enthusiasm. Well, I disagree. That's fine. You can disagree. Go talk to God about it and look at his Bible. See what his Bible says. Yeah. Not your opinion. Well, I just think. I don't care what you just think. What does the Bible say?
Yeah.
He went down there, cast out people with unclean spirits and caused joy. I said joy. Why? Because people were free. Are you here? People were free. God wants people free. Wants them delivered from sin. Wants them delivered from sickness. Wants them delivered from injury and calamity and destruction. Glory to God. And Philip went down and preached the anointed one. Things started happening. I mean, devils started coming out. People started getting healed. I mean, all of a sudden, there's great joy in the city. Notice, I'm on the rock climbing wall thing. Philip did not go down to Samaria and build a rock wall with a wine tasting center. That's a man thing. Why? Because there's a church in our area that advertises on the website. We drink wine. What? Church advertising. Now I'm going to be honest with you. So, Pastor, I don't think there's anything wrong with it. Now, here's my position. You get somebody come in church, there's an alcoholic. You get them delivered. You get them turned on to the Lord. And they walk out and they see you sitting down at such and such restaurant having a long neck or having a glass of wine, and they just got delivered from that. What am I going to do to them? What is my testimony going to do to them? Because my life is no longer mine. I'm hid with Christ. I have a responsibility to be a witness. Thank you for your enthusiasm. If I cause him to fail and to go back into sin and to die in a state of alcoholic drunkenness, I'm going to have to answer to the Lord for my freedom to drink whatever I want to drink. Yeah. That went over big. Just this grunt. But notice, that there was great joy. Now look here. Get off your soapbox. I'm off of it now. Come on. There's nothing wrong with soapboxes. As long as the Holy Ghost soapboxes. It says now, next. For before time, listen, For unclean spirits cried with loud voice, came out of many that were possessed with them. Many were taken with palsies, then lame were healed. There was great joy in the city. But there was a certain man called Simon, which before time in the same city used sorcery and bewitched the people of Samaria, giving out that himself was some great one, to whom they all gave heed from the least to the greatest, saying, this man is the great power of God. They were living in deception. They thought they had somebody in their midst. And this is the problem with pseudo-Christianity. We lead people into a belief that they're with God. They're in the presence of people of God. We've set them free to serve God. And all the time, they're still bound. I said, all the time, they're still bound. Until somebody shows up with the real stuff, with the right stuff. And then they find out. Now, a number of years ago, we had a lady in the church. And I had this word, had a word of knowledge. Somebody said, you're so bound, you can't even breathe deep. And finally, this person got up and came and says, I don't know. I can't really physically feel what you're talking about, but just it seems like it's me. I lay hands on them and command that thing to loose them in the name of Jesus. And they testified just a few minutes later and said, I've been bound out for so long I didn't even know I couldn't breathe free. I'm breathing deep and free for the first time in years. They thought they were free. It's one thing to think you're free. It's another thing to be free. Thank you. I said, thank you. There's a lot of people convincing themselves, you know, that it's cool to be, you know, uptown and upscale and not have any commitment and not have any dedication. The church got to stop playing games so we can get the captives free so they can serve God. It's not a matter of just coming in and appeasing their conscience of their need to be free from sin or to serve God. We want to set them free. Jesus said, they shall know the truth, and the truth shall set them, or one translation says, make them free. Make them or set them free. Depending on what Amplified says one way, King James says another. Amen. And then another place it says, sanctify them through thy word is truth. So truth is not, you know, we don't really use the Bible because we're free. As a matter of fact, I had a conversation with a guy not too long ago. We got the Holy Ghost in us. What about people who don't have Bibles? We got the Holy Ghost in us. We can serve God without a Bible. Oh, really? Wow. Well, that sure opens the door for you to preach whatever you want to preach and them to swallow hook, line, and sinker, because you don't have a Bible to go back to verify it with. Amen. You just tell them to follow what's in their heart. Yeah, goobity gawk. Why don't you go preach the word? Do you remember when Jesus appeared to the disciples on the road after his resurrection, that they had not seen him? And he began at Moses and the law and the prophets and began to show them who Christ was from the scriptures. And then he opened their eyes. But it was the scriptures that unveiled Jesus to them. Amen. What scriptures? The Old Testament ones. The writers of the New Testament didn't have a Bible. Yeah, they did. They were quoting it all the time. It is time for the church to get back to a place of power and authority. And I'm telling you, the first commission of the church is to win the lost, but to win them, to be endued with power from on high, so that when the Holy Ghost is on us, that dunamis power of God, we are enabled to go out and win the lost. Yes. Not convince them to come over to our church. We got this really cool stuff going on. Birth them in the power. Amen. I'm going to tell you, there are people who were birthed in the outpouring of Pentecost in the early 1900s who followed that their entire life. Some of them were young children and lived into their 80s and 90s and would have never. I mean, I'm going to tell you something. Some of the stuff that the people are doing now, the second, third generation, some of those folks have turned over three times. If they were still in the grave, they'd turn over three or four times. Maybe when they come back there and get their bodies, they're going to turn over a couple of times before they shoot out of the grave. I'm telling you. Because they knew what it was. Whose book was that, honey? The kids of Azusa Street. Who told their story. They told me their stories. This author went back and found all these people he could find who were in their 60s, 70s, or whatever, and documented their stories of being kids during Azusa Street. And I'm telling you, the things they saw and the things they experienced shaped their lives because of the power of God. They told me their stories. Something you ought to read, because I'll tell you what, the stuff they saw in those meetings as children, shaping their lives. We need to be shaping people's lives with the power of God. We need to be evangelizing in the anointing. Amen. We don't need to have the coolest, we don't need to hire a marketing director so we can look slick. We need to have the Holy Ghost director direct us in the way we should go. Amen. I got more people than you. I'm not concerned about that. How many people are being birthed in the power and their lives are being transformed? I'd rather take one transformed than 300 faking it. We've got to understand the number one mission of the church is to evangelize the world in the power of God. Amen. I saw a nation lose what they had with God because they got cute. I went into a nation right after communism fell. It was one of the first nations to secede from the Soviet Union. When I went in there, they were so hungry for God and the power of God. They were seeking God and they were hungry for God. And their nation was turning. But then people came in and started getting cute with evangelism and, wearing the clerical collars and all this kind of stuff, trying to be, whatever. And sapped the power right out of that thing. And now they're just like everybody. They're so caught up in, in image and everything else. And they're last time I went over and spent some time with some of those guys, the same guys that were all about the power of God and praying for the sick, casting out devils and being baptized in the Holy Ghost, all they wanted to talk about was okay to drink wine. That's all they cared about. Their new doctrine was it okay to drink wine? They had a revelation. Man, go back to the revelation that brought your country out of bondage. Go back to the revelation that brought down the iron curtain in your nation. Go back to the revelation where you saw people getting set free and there was a hunger for God. Not, okay, we've had all that now. Is it okay to drink wine? And I'm telling you, the time before when I flew out of that nation and the next time when I flew back into that nation, you could tell that when I hit the ground, when the wheels touched down, you could sense the change in the spiritual atmosphere. Because it was no longer about the power of God. And I tell you, America, the American church, there is a crisis taking place. But we have to follow after God. And if every church in America has Ichabod written, and I know they won't. But if everyone does and they have Ichabod written over the door that the Spirit of God's departed. And they're doing all these cool, slick things. And they're all just talking about how wonderful it is. And the pastor's driving Lamborghinis and wearing $5,000 shoes, handcrafted shoes. And, $10,000 hand-tailored suits. And he's blinged out. Make Mr. T look poor. How many remember Mr. T? I pity the fool. Now, Mr. T is a Christian. I think his street evangelism goes something like this. Fool, get saved. You're going to hell now. Okay, something like that. Hallelujah. But Mr. T blings out. You know what I'm talking about? Hallelujah. I am committed to winning the lost in the power of God. This church has to be committed. We're changing our focus coming into this new year. It's going to be about the loss. It's going to be about the power. It's going to be about the mission of the church to get out there in the highways and the byways and compel them to come in. You're not going to compel them to come in. Hello. Because you have, techno classrooms for the nursery. Can I say something in closing? I asked this question not too long ago on Facebook. With all the technology, the computers in the classroom, I mean the satellite uplinks, the worldwide connections, the social pages, all the technological advancements we have for education, how come we don't have people walking around like the founding fathers who had none of that? Hello. Those were brilliant. You look at the Constitution of the United States of America, that is a brilliant document. They passed laws. The health care thing was how many, 2,000 pages? Nobody read it. And then they started reading it. They found out the stuff contradicts itself. It's all convoluted. It's all messed up. Why? Because you didn't have people like the founding fathers writing it. The Constitution of the United States of America is a brilliant document. They didn't have a computer. They didn't have an iPhone. They didn't have the internet. Hello? What do they call those people who work? They didn't have a clerk. Hello? These were brilliant men. And I said that to make this point. The church, I'm for technology, for using it as a tool. But it cannot be a superseding technology, gimmicks, playground equipment, cool stuff cannot be a replacement for the anointing and the power of God in people's lives. The church cannot release the anointing in lieu of being slick and cool and marketable. Amen. Because when people are in crisis, are you listening to me? The fact that you think it's okay to drink a glass of wine is not going to help them. Amen. When the doctor says you got 6 months to live. Oh, well, we're sorry to hear that. Well, take advantage of the rock climbing wall as much as you can while you can. Make sure you have 2 or 3 glasses of Chardonnay. That way you can, it'll relax you so you can really enjoy the experience. Church, I'm telling you, if we're going to reach the lost, if we're going to help the lost, we're going to have to do it in the power of God. We're going to have to evangelize in the anointing. We're going to have to go out in the power of the Holy Ghost. Amen? You're going to have to be able to go out to people and lay hands on them and minister life to them. Praise God. I'm going to tell you, when I worked at Parker's Barbecue down in Greenville, I thought we were going to get done early today. How many give me 5 more minutes? 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35. Can I get 40, 45, 50, 50, 50. Okay. All right, that's 45 more minutes. All right, thank you. I remember one time, now, when I got saved and turned on to the Lord and everything, and I went to Raymond, I came back, I really couldn't get a job in my field, which was computer programming. So I went back to my old job working in the restaurant. And now, understand, back in those days, it was all black girls and all white guys because the bosses didn't want everybody fraternizing in the kitchen. What they didn't know was it was still fraternizing going on. All white guys and all black girls is not necessarily a recipe for nobody getting together. Are you here? I went on way before Parker's Barbecue showed up. Well, anyway, who was it? Was it Margaret Earls who used to go to church here? She took her husband to a family reunion one time, and all these white folks started showing up. He said, "Margaret, who are all them people?" She said, "They're my cousins." Hallelujah. Yeah, that's the white side of the family. A little mixing went on in there. All right. He was like, all these white people here at your family reunion, what's this all about? My cousins, all right. But they used to call me brother. That was my nickname, was brother. And they kind of would mock me. Janie would come in, she'd have pants on. Boy, she wasn't saved, because she was wearing that which pertaineth to a man. No, Ellen wears that which pertaineth to a man. She tries to look like a man. That's what the Bible was talking about, trying to look like a man. Hello. But I'm telling you, I noticed that whenever one of them was hurting or sick, one of them came in one day and they found a lump in their breast. They didn't go to the guys who drank all the time and said, "I need prayer." They didn't go to the guys who cussed and talked dirty all the time and said, I need prayer. It wasn't brother with the attitude. It was, brother, I need for you to pray for me. I found a lump this morning. We just stepped out in the hallway. I laid hands on their head and I cursed it, commanded to die and to wither and to dry up. Came back the next day, it was gone. They come in and say, you know, I was a kitchen manager, and they would say, I don't feel good today. I need to go home. I said, okay, let me pray for you first. You go sit in the break room 10 or 15 minutes, and if you still feel bad, go home. Well, they come in, about 10 or 15 minutes, they come in, clocked in, came to work, they felt better. Well, after a few months of that, next thing I know, they started coming into work going, brother, I got saved last night. Praise God. We started having revival. Because they started having a confrontation with the power of God that demonstrated God loved them enough to heal them. Amen. Lumps were disappearing. Sicknesses were going. Hey, are you here? And they started going to church and getting saved. They weren't coming to my church. Who cares? They were coming to the church. I didn't care. Just get saved. Serve the Lord. Amen? We had revival going on in there. Not one time did I try to get them. Just convince him. Well, we first came to Greensboro, we had a guy in the church, and he brought this girl in one Sunday, and she's sitting there on the side of the church at the church. And I kind of walk over there a little bit, you know, listen, you know, pastors are smart. And I didn't walk over there and just stick my nose in. I just kind of stood over there and talked to somebody, but didn't really listen to what the person was saying. I was listening to them. Because I thought something went right over here. And I listened long to figure out, he's trying to convince her she's saved. And she's telling him, I don't want to be saved. But you say you prayed the prayer. But I didn't mean it. Yes, you did. I know you did. You dummy. So I walked there. I just stopped it. I said, honey, did you want to be a Christian? Did you want Jesus to be Lord of your life? She said, no. She said, he just got me to pray it. And, you know, I kind of just did it to get him off my case. I said, well, look, here's the thing. Don't you struggle with whether you're saved or not. You're not. Now, listen, understand. Whenever you're ready to give your heart to Jesus, you can come back here. Or you can go anywhere. You can pray and Jesus will save you. But you got to mean it from your heart. Right. He didn't like that. Because it was one of his crowns. It was one of his trophies. You can't convince people they're saved if they're not. They'll live and struggle with that. Yes. And there'll be no power in their life. They'll walk around conflicted. Well, I'm supposed to be a Christian, but I want to get drunk and have sex and do all this other stuff. I really don't want to serve God. And live in a schizophrenic kind of a state. I said, God loves you. God wants to save you. Jesus died for you. And when you're ready, you just give your heart to him. Boy, it made him mad. I don't really care. You can't fake people. We just had somebody come and tell us one time. We got everybody at the juvenile detention center saved tonight. How? Well, we gave an altar call. We said everybody that wants to reject Jesus, take a step backwards. Nobody did, so they all got saved. What? This isn't about tricking people in. It's about having the power of God to the place they can't stand it not to get in. They want in, baby. They're knocking at the door. Let me in. Mark Brzee was in a place one time, and I'm going to close right here. He went into Germany or Poland or somewhere, and he had preached a sermon, and he was going to give his altar call. He said, everybody here that wants to give Jesus Christ, to give their heart to Jesus Christ, please stand up. Everybody in the building stood up. He said, no, sit back down. You don't understand. Now, if you've never accepted the Lordship of Jesus Christ, if you've never been saved, you've never come to know him, I would like for everybody in the building that wants to receive Jesus as their Lord, please stand up. And everybody stood up. He said, no. He told his interpreter, sit back down. Maybe I'm not explaining myself properly. And finally, the interpreter said, they're not saved. They're all unsaved. Everybody wants to get saved. 1,500 people. Everybody wanted to get saved. See, he wasn't trying to trick them in. He was thinking, no, that can't be right. There's got to be at least one Christian in the building. Nope, none of them were saved. So they all got born again. Well, praise God. I said, praise God. Amen. 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 I mean, okay, you know, us ministers, we're used to, if we get one person, we're like, woo! Hit the whole building. They preached a message, thought, man, praise God, we're having a good time here, and everybody in the building's lost. But they all came in. Weren't tricked in. weren't shucked and jived in. They came in because they wanted to serve Jesus. If we walk in the power. So the number one mission of the church is to walk in the anointing and evangelize the world in the power of God so that people come in and are birthed in the power and not tricked in by a gimmick. If you want to get saved tonight, squeeze the hand of the person beside you. You're now a Christian. No, you're not. The Bible says if you will confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. Squeeze in somebody's hand. Come up and shake the preacher's hand after service and you'll be saved. What kind of cockamamie stuff is this? Jesus, listen, it's a bold declaration. I'm telling you, when I got saved, I didn't care who knew it. As a matter of fact, I would preach, I got three stop signs saved, they turned into go signs. Hallelujah. Yep, caused a couple problems. I had to go get them changed back. Anyway. Okay, yeah, some of y'all enjoyed that. The rest of you are like, huh? Hallelujah. The power in the church. People are out there in the world, and they're being told that if you'll vote for this candidate or vote for that candidate, everything's going to be all right. This one didn't get us into trouble. This one's going to get us out of trouble. I'm going to tell you something. You better get your faith out of Republican, Democrat, Independent, Libertarian, honky, white, black. You better get your faith out of a man, and you better get your faith into Jesus Christ and know how to take your stand in good economic times, bad economic times, difficult economic times, wonderful economic times. You better know how to believe God. It don't matter who's sitting in the White House, who's sitting in Congress, who's the governor of your state, and who's on your county commission board. You better know how to believe God and walk by faith and not by sight, no matter what the political scene is. Amen.
Amen.
And put all your faith in. Oh, if we can get so-and-so elected next time, it's going to be everything's going to be different. Uh-huh. Everybody in Germany thought when they elected Hitler, everything was going to be different. It was. It took a whole nation down the tubes with them. They got crazy. Hello. Get your confidence out of a man. Get your confidence out of a political system. And get your confidence in the Lord. Amen. We need to be getting people saved, filled with the Holy Ghost, delivered by the power of God, and trusting the Lord. I'm telling you, you know, we could be $30 trillion in debt in 4 more years. But if you know how to believe God, if you know how to believe God, you can survive and live in victory. Healthcare, the healthcare law may ruin our healthcare. If you know how to believe God, you can stay well. Y'all hear you going home. Get your focus and eyes off of what's going on around you and give people a hope. Dad Hagin said this. He said, we got to give people a hope before we can get them in the faith. Because hope, faith is the evidence of things hoped for. Let's start giving them some hope that there's an answer. And Jesus is the answer. And then get them into faith to receive in Jesus by the power of God. Amen. Father, we thank you for our time together. Thank you. We're starting out this new year with a different direction. And that is the church and her mission. We're going to walk in our mission. We're going to walk in our calling. We're going to fulfill our destiny as the people of God. As every head's bowed and every eye's closed, I want to ask, is anybody here today you're not born again? Jesus Christ is not the Lord of your life. Now, I'm not asking you if you ever joined the church, had first communion, been water baptized, shook the preacher's hand. I mean, I'm asking you, have you ever come to a point you with your mouth said, Jesus, come out of my heart. I believe God raised you from the dead. Now, maybe I have to say those words verbatim, but you're Jesus saved me, come into my heart. You confessed his lordship. If you're here today and you're not born again, you know it. Raise your hand. I want to pray with you. Anybody here today? Second offer. If you're here today, I know I've been born again, but I'm backslid as you can get. I'm just went out and started living like the world. not happy there. There's no joy there. I have to find ways to appease my conscience because there's no joy in serving and living in the world. I want to get right with God this morning. You're backslid. You know what you want to get right this morning. Raise your hand. One more offer. If you're here this morning, you're not baptized in the Holy Ghost, speaking in other tongues, and you want to be filled with the Spirit, raise your hand. I'll pray with you. Lay hands on you. You'll be filled with the Spirit. Praise God. Okay. I'll accept your testimony. Look up at me. Everybody stand up. Hallelujah.